Hello, welcome. Let's discuss the PIB analysis of 14th February 2021. In this video, we will discuss different PIB articles, important PIB articles of that session. Regarding the first article, Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurates and lays foundation stone various key projects in Tamil Nadu. And he hands over firstly Arjun main battle tank MK-1A to the army, and he pays homage to the Pulwama attacks and focus on making India Atmanirbhar Bharat in the defense sector, and different projects are inaugurated, which are the symbols of the innovation and indigenous developments. These projects will further improve the growth of the Tamil Nadu, said the PM. The budget gives special importance to the Indian coastal areas regarding the PM Matsya Sampada Yojana, all these things. And another thing, very important thing, that is the Devendra Kula Velalar community has been given a heritage name for the 7 SC categories which have been grouped under this category, which is a long-standing demand of the Tamil Nadu. And government has also taken various steps regarding all these things. First of all, we will see the what is the Arjun main battle tank MK-1A. Let's get into like started. See the first article. What is all about Arjun main battle tank MK-1A? This is the new version MK-1A. The Arjun main battle tank project was initiated by DRDO in 1972, way back in the 1972, with the Combat Vehicle Research and Development Establishment as its lead laboratory, which is the under DRDO, the lead laboratory, that is the Combat Vehicle Research and Development Establishment, that is the CVRDE. In 1972 has initiated the project of the Arjun main battle tank project. And coming into the article, the army will get 118 units newly. These main battle tanks, which are indigenously designed and developed, manufactured by the CVDRE and DRDO, along with 15 academic institutions, 8 labs, and several MSMEs, all these things are involved. First of all, what is Arjun main battle tank? It is a project, we already seen it. It was a project initiated by DRDO in 1972 under the CVRDE as its lead laboratory. The objective of this project was to create state-of-the-art tank with the superior firepower and high mobility and excellent protection. All these things are the objectives of the Arjun main battle tank. What were the objectives? State of art tank with superior firepower is the first thing. And second thing is the high mobility in the cross-border areas and excellent protection for the army. These three are the objectives. And coming to the other things, the CVRDE have achieved breakthrough in its engine transmission and hydropneumatic suspension, hull and turret, as well as gun control system. These are all the integral part of this main battle tank. The mass production of this main battle tank has been began in 1996 in the Indian Ordnance Factories, at the which is situated in the Avadi, Tamil Nadu. These are the things regarding the Arjun main battle tank. And the other things are, Arjun tanks stand out for their unstabilized armor piercing discarding sabot ammunition. This is one type of ammunition which the Arjun main tanks have stand out for their achievement, that is the fin stabilized armor piercing discarding sabot, FSA PDS. This is a one type of ammunition used in this battle tank, and 120 mm caliber rifled gun has been attached to it, and it has also a computer controlled integrated fire control systems. Also having computer controlled integrated fire control system, and with a stabilizing sighting in the light conditions and in the day conditions. And the secondary weapons included a coaxial 7.62 mm machine gun for anti-personnel, and 12.7 mm machine gun for the anti-aircraft and for the different ground targets. All these things are not important. Just see a look at them and leave it. And regarding some different facts, the Indian Army received the first batch of these tanks, 16 tanks in 2004, and 43 Armored Regiment. These 16 tanks are handed over to the squadron of the 43 Armored Regiment. And in 2009, this Arjun Regiment of the Indian Army has 45 tanks. From 2004 to 2009, the tanks has been increased from 16 to 45 tanks. By 2011, over 100 tanks have been delivered. In 2010, the Indian Army ordered 124 more Arjuns, and now the Ministry of Defense ordered another 118 new units of Arjun MK1A tanks, which were revised cost of these all units are 8,400 crores. What is this MK1A version? This is a new version which has 14 major updates. It is supposed to have missile firing capability as designed, but the feature is added later as a final testing of the capability is still on. However, the biggest achievement in this MK1A is compared with the old version is 54.3% of the content of the main battle tank is the indigenous content, which is compared to the earlier mode. This is the biggest achievement of the this main battle tank. And coming to the other things, recently a bill has been passed regarding the Devendra Kula Velalar community has been designated as their demanding name, that is the Devendra Kula Velalar community. Various 6 to 7 SC categories has been listed and grouped, and they were named as the Devendra Kula community in the schedule of the constitution of the SCs. And the draft gadget to this is the constitutional schedule to correct their name has been approved by the central government recently, and it will be placed before the parliament before the start of the next session. This is the another update from the yesterday's inauguration. And coming to the other things, that's all. Nothing is important from this article. And coming to the other things, this is the Arjun MK1A battle tank. Coming to the specifications, these speeds, all these things are not important. The combat weight of this is 68 tons. And coming to the gun, 120 mm rifled gun, and 6 to 8 rounds per minute rate of firing, and it is having ammunition, 13 ammunition rounds, that is the FSA PDS type of ammunition, and anti-aircraft machine gun with 12.7 mm, and fire control systems, day and night stabilizer sight, and night vision, thermal images, and drivers with the night sight has been shown here. And coming to the other things. The bill regarding the naming of the 7 SC categories as Devendra Kollar Velalar community has been introduced on Saturday. The name of the bill is the Constitution Scheduled Caste Order Amendment Bill 2021. Grouped 7 Scheduled Caste has the Devendra Kollar community in certain districts of the Tamil Nadu. And what are these communities means? Let's see a look at it. The communities are Devendra Kollar Velalar community, which are this Kalladi and Kudumbam, Pallan, Pannadi. Sorry, not all these things. Devendra Kulatan, Kadiyan, and all these things are confusing. We'll refer it in somewhere. These are the things. Devendra Kulatan, Kudumbam, Pannadi, Kaladi, Kadayan, Pallan, and Patariyan. These are the 7 categories, SC categories, which were renamed as the Devendra Kula Velalar community. And coming to the next article. It is from the Department of Agriculture regarding a seed development program. A submission on the seeds and planting materials has been introduced to produce and supply quality seeds to the farmers to enhance the production and productivity in the country through various components, namely seed village program and establishment of the seed processing cum storage facility godowns at the panchayat, gram panchayat level, and national seed reserve, and boosting seed production in the private sector and strengthening of the quality of control of the infrastructure of facilities. These all these things. And coming to the major achievement under the scheme from 2014 to 2015 and 2020-21, let's see, under the seed program, 4.29 lakh number of seed villages have been created, wherein 38.1 lakh quintals of the foundation certified seeds were distributed at concessional rates to nearly 170.86 lakh farmers. And to encourage the farmers, take up of the seed production of the oil, pulses, fodder, green manure crops locally made available, required the certification of the seeds at village itself, and 10.05 lakh quintals of foundation certified seeds have been distributed. That is the 75% of the at the subsidized rates to the 2.61 lakh farmers. All these things are not important. Just you have to have a common idea about what is the submission on seed and planting materials. That's enough for you. And coming to the next article. LRSAM missiles. In this perspective, you have to remember what is LRSAM and regarding all these things. The LRSAM is a missile jointly developed by the DRDO and IAI of the Israel to equip the latest ships of the Indian Navy. The LRSAM missiles have been inducted into the Indian Navy. This LRSAM missile system can provide point and area defense against various aerial targets. That is the for example, a point target, that is for a naval ship, you have to point out enemy's naval ship, that is the point target. Aerial target, for example, some sort of area you have to target using that missile ship. In this perspective, it is having both the aerial target as well as point target, including fighter aircraft and subsonic and supersonic cruise missile has its components. And the missile is powered by indigenously developed dual pulse rocket motor and dual control system to impart the required maneuverability at the terminal phase. That is, required maneuverability means it can rotate in all directions. That's why required maneuverability in the terminal phase. This state of art weapon system is designated with the active radio frequency seeker, that is the RF seeker, to identify, freely engage and destroy the target with high kill probability. And LRSAM system has end-to-end performance, having successfully demonstrated through number of use field trials from the Indian naval ship. The weapon has been successfully productionized and been delivered to the Indian Navy so far. And all these things are nothing important from this perspective. LRSAM, what are the key points? LRSAM is jointly developed by the DRDO and IAI of the Israel, and it is having both the point and the area defense targets, and having the fighter aircraft and subsonic and supersonic cruise missiles as its components. And it is also having active radio frequency seeker. Apart from this, it is having indigenously developed dual pulse rocket motor as well as dual control system. All these things, apart from this, nothing is important. And coming to the next article, Hunar Haat. You have to see what is the Hunar Haat. A platform has been initiated for the promotion of the various products of the indigenous products of the artisans and craftsmen across the country. This Hunar Haat website has been portal has been inaugurated recently. And coming to the next article, this is somewhat a report regarding the rights of the children in the Jammu Kashmir and Ladakh. What are the important issues and concerns in the children of the Jammu Kashmir and Ladakh after the formation of the both territories as a union territories? Use of the children for various illegal activities will invite rigorous punishment up to 7 years and fine of 5 lakh rupees under the schemes which are in force in the mainland of the India as well. Coming to the article, the law against using the children as stone pelters and to punish the persons who are using the children as stone pelters, that law have been applicable to the Union Territory of the Jammu Kashmir and the Ladakh as well after the abrogation of the Article 370, said the Union Minister of State for the Personal Public Grievances, Pensions and Atomic Energy. The chairman for the National Commission for Protection of the Child Rights has been discussed the important issues concerning the rights of the children in Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh, which had emerged from the analysis of recently conducted various reports by the NCPCR, and it emphasized the need for the implementation of Juvenile Justice Act, implementation of the Juvenile Justice Act in the Jammu, Kashmir and the Ladakh, these two territories. And coming to the other things, the Justice Juvenile Act has been enacted in 2015. According to the Section 83(1) of the Juvenile Justice Act, any non-state or self-styled militant group or outfit declared as such by the central government if it recruits or uses any children for the purpose, or shall be liable for the rigorous punishment. If any militant group or non-state group or self-styled militant group recruits the children and uses them for the illegal purposes, then it shall be liable for the rigorous imprisonment for a term of up to 7 years and shall be liable for the fine of the 5 lakh rupees. And section 83.2 says that if the state actor, apart from the non-state actor, if the same state actor indulges in the using of the children for the illegal activities in the militants or other things, it is punishable either individually or gang shall be liable for the rigorous imprisonment up to term of the 7 years and shall be liable to the fine of the 5 lakh rupees. This is the implications of the Juvenile Justice Act for this punishment. And by this implication, anyone responsible for inducing or using the children in stone peddling or any other violent activities will face the serious action under the law. Coming to the other things. Implications of the POKSO Act of 2012 has been also now applicable to the Jammu Kashmir and the Ladakh. This thing has been effectively seen by the ministry also regarding the other. And coming to the next article. That is the Prime Minister Modi inaugurated various foundation stones and various projects in the Kochi, Kerala. One of them is the different terminal, a terminal regarding the Sagarika terminal, and that is the other thing is the polypropylene derivative petrochemical project and RoRo vessels. All these things have been inaugurated. Coming to the first thing, is the polypropylene derivative petrochemical project, PDPP, has been inaugurated. It will help strengthen the India's journey towards the Atmanirbhar Bharat and save the foreign money exchange. What is this all about? Propylene derivative petrochemical project. It generally makes the propylene have been involved in the production of the propylene, involved in the production of the petrochemical products. That's why the major products regarding the propylene, and it reduces the efficiency, hurdles and burden on the vehicle engine. That's why, and other things are, it is very effective compared to the conventional petrol. That's why it is a boosting step towards the Atmanirbhar Bharat, and thus it saves some money regarding the foreign exchange. And coming to the other things, that is the RoRo vessels. RoRo vessels have been inaugurated. What is this all about? RoRo vessels means this RoRo stands for the rolling off and rolling on. These special type of ships, RoRo ships, generally carry the containers which are the movable vehicles, for example cars, vehicles, or these things which are the movable by their own on the ships and off the ships on the roads. They are the movable. That's why this is called as the rolling off and rolling on ships. Coming to the other conventional containers, which is not having any something wheels like structures, whereas this RoRo vessels specially contain the vehicle type containments. And that's why because of this RoRo vessels introduction, there will be a reducing in the distance of 30 kilometers conventional on the road to the now 3.5 kilometer on the waterways through these ro-ro vessels. And coming to the other things, international cruise terminal at Kochi has been inaugurated. That is the Sagarika cruise terminal, it will cater or it will serve to over a lakh cruise guests has been catered by this Sagarika cruise terminal. And coming to the Sagarika cruise terminal, because of this all these things, the tourism will be improved, blue economy will be improved, and tourism will be improved. In the last 5 years, when you see, India's tourism sector has been grown substantially, and the World Tourism Index, on which the India's ranking has been improved significantly from 65th in last 5 years, and now 34th in the 2020, has been improved in a significant amount. And these are the facts regarding this article. And coming to the other things, he also talks about the farmers' welfare regarding, fisheries welfare. In this perspective, he talks about the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. It is an umbrella scheme to develop the fisheries sector with a total outlay of 20,050 crores. And it has two components. One is the central sector scheme and the other one is the centrally sponsored scheme. Central sector scheme having two components. One is the non-beneficiary oriented scheme. Other one is the beneficiary oriented scheme. Under the beneficiary oriented scheme, the central assistant for the general category will get the 40%, and for the SC, ST and the women categories, it will get the 60% assistant. That way, it will cover as a whole 100% from the central assistance and centrally sponsored scheme. Coming to the centrally sponsored scheme, the central assistant for the northeastern state is as usual 90%, for the other states is 60%. For UTs, center will give 100%. It is also two types, non-beneficiary oriented and beneficiary oriented scheme. The central sponsor scheme component of the PM Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana will cover the three broad sub-components. What are the three sub-components? Are the enhancement of the production and productivity of the fisheries and infrastructure post-harvest management. For the post-harvest management of the fisheries and fisheries products, the infrastructure has to be created. And the final thing is the fisheries management and regulatory framework for the development of the fisheries. These things are the, these are the sub-components of the PMMSY central sponsored scheme. And it intends to work on the fishes production and fisheries production, fish production, fisheries production, quality of the fisheries and the aquaculture sector and post-harvest management and modernization of the value chain and welfare of the fishers and the fishermen and the fisheries management framework, all these things. And coming to the other things, what is the objective of the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana? It will harvest the potential of the fisheries sector and is responsible for the sustainable, responsible, inclusive in the equity manner. And it helps in the efficient use of the land and water resources in order to enhance the fish production and the productivity. And it also modernizes the value chain with regard to the post-harvest management of the fisheries, and double the fisher and the fish farmers' income, and generate the employment in the fisheries sector and enhance the fisheries sector contribution to overall agriculture gross value addition and the different exports, and provide social, economic and physical security to the fish farmers and fishermen. And it will develop a robust fisheries management and regulatory framework. And coming to the other things, the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana significance, it will increase the fish production from 13.75 million metric tons to 22 million metric tons by 2025. And increase the fisheries sector's gross value addition contribution in the agriculture GVA by from 7.28% to 9% by 2025, and double the export earnings from ₹46,589 crores to 1 lakh crores by 2025, and it also decrease in the post harvestment loss from 25% to the 10%. And generation of 15 lakh direct employment and opportunities, and increase the domestic fish consumption per capita consumption of 5 kg to the 12 kg. And these are the important aspects. And coming to the next article. These are all the things of the PIB of yesterday.